I'm Representative Mindy Fee, and you're joining us with the Legislative Report, so thank you. Today we are at an institution just on the south side of Mannheim, and we're at Roots Country Market and Auction. And I'm joined today with Tom Longenecker, who's the president, and fifth generation of Roots Market?
I'm the fourth, but we do have fifth generation family members on the maintenance staff right now.
Oh, that's is that where you start, on the maintenance
staff? That's where you start.
I love that. you've been here since 1925, so, and on the ground that we're on now?
Yes. Mm-hmm. It's just changed a little bit over the years, but yes.
Tell us how it started. It was your fourth generation ago, so how did it start as a feed mill auction, right?
It started in 1925 as a poultry auction.
Oh, okay.
That came out of the failure of a farmer's co-op that was across the street at the time, lost in the Depression. The poultry auction started, and then people who attended the auction started bringing baked goods and other things to sell while they waited for the auction to go through. And that's how the market started.
And when it started, it was just one building, I assume? And
it was primarily the poultry auction building that's over there.
Okay.
The other end of the building.
And the poultry auction still goes on today?
Still goes on today.
Yeah, we'll get a chance to see that hopefully a little later. Today, here we are. How many vendors do we have?
On the country market side here, we have about 250 stand holders. There's about 200 or 150 over at the flea market across the street. But right now, about 250 here on the country market side.
So let's review the stands a little bit and tell the audience about them. Are they also done by generation and generation? I mean, are they the same families that have had the stands here?
There's a number of stands here that are multiple generations. In fact, we're standing right next to one now. The soft pretzel stand here, the equipment was built by the present owner's great-grandfather.
Oh my goodness.
So that's third and fourth generation as well.
I love that. I love that. So go through your family history. When did you personally start here at Roots Auction?
Well, I was on the maintenance staff when I was in high school. Then we'll jump to 1983. That's when I came back to the family business at that point.
Okay.
So I've been here a little over 30 some years.
Over 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
Now, do you have any other siblings involved? Any brothers, sisters?
As owners, as board of directors, yes. I'm the full-time family member here on the grounds.
Oh, that's great. So, Tuesdays.
Yes.
We're only open on Tuesdays. Why Tuesday?
I get that question a lot. People had to attend the market or attend the poultry auction on Tuesday to buy live birds. They would take them home to dress them and then sell them to the city markets over the weekend. So the buyers at the poultry were here for live birds to time it for the weekend.
To time it for the weekend.
Right.
Okay, and what's our hours of operation on Tuesday?
We're open. We were scheduled 9 till 9, but we're open all day. This is a 6 a.m. to 9 p.m. operation around here.
Okay. And rain doesn't, you know, we're in, we're out, we have people inside, we have people outside, so we're open no matter what the weather.
Right. Every Tuesday, all year long.
Have you ever been closed?
I have. Less than 10 times since 1925.
Boy, that's fantastic.
And they were for some major snowstorms.
That, for snowstorms.
Right.
Yeah, they can shut you down.
They can do a number on you.
So, as all the people are milling around here, are they local people? Where do the customers come from?
We concentrate our advertising on local customers. We do get our fair share of tourists and whatever, but we concentrate our efforts on getting the locals back every week for their food.
I'll tell you, and it is amazing to me. I have friends whose mothers live in Virginia, their parents, and guess what? They come here. They plan their vacations or their stops in Lancaster County on Tuesdays for Roots Markets.
We like hearing about that.
Yeah, that's a good thing. How many employees does it take to get this up and running?
Well, the market itself, we have a very small staff, but every standholder usually has a couple people working. So you're talking easily, you know, 700-800 employees when you count the staff that supports every individual business.
Yeah, so that's fantastic, because, you know, just to help the economy is a great thing. And, you know, it is, I mean, truly, it's the people who are growing their food and bringing it here to sell it, right?
We support the local agriculture stand any way we can.
You know, it's also a very social thing. You know, my parents would come and sit every Tuesday and drink their coffee and then gather together with friends
and
neighbors.
It's been a meeting place for years. You know, people come to catch up with lost friends and family.
Yeah. Yeah. Is there any funny or unique stories that you have from the auction through all those years?
Over the years, we've had some very unique stand holders. There was one that predates my involvement, but I've heard about him many times. He sold an elixir of some sort, and he was a strong man. So he performed acts of strength here for the public.
So if you drink his elixir, you are going to be very strong.
Yeah. Now, that hasn't been... He hasn't been around since, I think, the 50s. But
well, that was before my time, because I came as a kid. Yeah, that's a great story. Well, we will take a tour around and head from stand to stand, maybe get to talk to a few of the stand holders and go from there. So let's head on and see what the market has to offer today.
Very well. Thank you.
So part of the auction is the Graystone Small Animal Sale.
That's a spinoff of the Roots Market.
And you, sir, are the owner of the company,
exactly.
Ernest Hoover. So I appreciate you taking a moment to talk to us today.
Okay.
So tell me, how did the Graystone sale get started? Were you the actual owner of it?
The actual animal sale started before any of this was here. That was the beginning of the market here. Is that correct, Tom? And it's, 90 years now?
Yep.
And it's still going strong. And, everybody's going back to the grassroots.
Yeah, they are, which is a wonderful thing. They want to go get their food and their produce from those who actually grow it. I love that.
I mean, it's a big hobby. The small animals is a hobby. And a lot of people, they need something to do. And I think if the young people get into this, it keeps them off the streets and into other stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. So tell me something. You sell mainly to the people who have backyard flocks or backyard animals?
Anybody. I mean, we have regular dealers that come every week.
Okay.
We have people that sell for meat. We have people for the pet stores. We have people for the snake food. It's all, you know, whatever they want it for, it's here for them to buy.
Okay, so go run the gamut for me. What animals are being sold here?
Ducks, chickens, rabbits, mice, rats, hamsters, parrots, pigeons, guinea pigs, chickens. I don't know what else is there.
Did you ever have a parrot that maybe was a little funny?
We had parrots that talk.
Did you?
Goats and sheep. Yeah.
So
turtles.
What role do you play? So you go out and you're out gathering the animals?
It's all consignment. I don't know what's coming. All I do is make sure people get paid for what they bring in, and try and get the money back from the people that buy the stuff.
So the actual farmers or the breeders are the ones that are bringing their animals here, all done on consignment.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Great. So when do you set up? I mean, when are they bring them in?
We start Tuesday morning.
Tuesday morning, early in the morning.
Till Tuesday, the building's empty Tuesday morning, and by 10 o'clock Tuesday night, it's empty again.
Completely empty. All right. So during the auction, what time is your auction? Let's let people know that too.
Right around 5, 4:45.
4:45.
We start 4:45, yes.
Okay. And what's your favorite part about it?
Oh, I enjoy the whole thing. I love small animals. I wouldn't be sticking around here 40 years.
Yeah, that's a good thing. So let's talk about something very serious, because something we've been working on up in Harrisburg diligently. I met with the Secretary of Ag, Secretary Redding, and I'll tell you, I think they're working to be prepared. It's, of course, avian flu.
Okay.
It hit a few other states, and, you know, we want to make sure we don't have it in Pennsylvania yet, but... you know, it could come at any moment, which we know that. So it's important to be prepared. But a lot of my larger chicken with the layers and things, you know, they know. And the secretary used a term with me, biosecurity, which is a very important term. But I always said it's a very scary term. But in reality, what it is, you know, making sure your shoes that you go out and feed the chickens with aren't taken to the grocery store to be able to spread things. So give me your thoughts on how you handle that here.
I have chickens at home. I had chickens at home for 20 some years. Never had sick chickens. I'm here every week. We get tested on a regular basis. We're negative 99% of the time. We're negative. And the ones that come back positive, they're never positive back on the farm.
Okay, good.
So it's
so you're doing your part to make sure the biosecurity is being taken care of. That's great. That's great to hear. Well, I thank you very much for taking the time.
Well, thank you for talking to me.
Sure, absolutely.
I can express my opinion.
No, that's a good thing. That's a good thing. And I hope Graystone's here for another 40 years. So it's good stuff. And next, we're going to head over to the produce auction and see what those folks have to sell today. So now we're at the Schuler Produce Auction, and I gotta tell you, this is one of my favorite parts of Rook's Country Market. And we're with Steve Schuler. Thank you, Steve, for joining us today. So you are the manager of the produce auction.
Yes.
And tell me about the history. Is it been family owned?
It's been family owned since I think it's the late 90s. I personally have become the manager in I think it's the late 2010. So it's this fall will be 5 years since I've took over management.
So you know what you're doing with it.
Well, try to act that way.
So yeah. The way the auction runs, let's let people know, because I have been here many times, sure. The way the auction runs is the produce starts on the front of the building
first. That's
correct. What time does that start?
We start at 1 o'clock.
Every
Tuesday at 1 o'clock, unless the snow's too deep, but we're here year round. Yes.
Well, and they told me earlier they haven't shut down many times here at Woods Market.
Very many times, no.
So then we come out here to the flowers.
Yes, that's correct.
And then lastly.
That varies in the year, you know, like right now there's not a lot of flowers, but in the spring we'll start as early as 3 o'clock with our flower auction. And then we'll have up to three auctioneers going. Two with flowers, one that'll still sell vegetables.
So they both run
so we'll
simultaneously.
Yeah, like three different rings running at the same time.
Yeah, and when I came, I mean, there are many people that come to the auction and bid on it. Do they come, are they just like me who want to buy it for their backyard? Or?
Mostly. Most of the people are people that just want it for their own use. There's a few restaurants, some caterers. A big thing that's becoming a big point for us is organic produce.
Oh, certainly.
More and more, we have a good person that brings us a lot of organic produce, and that's becoming a big thing, which is
fantastic. Sure.
Anywhere. So, yeah.
So where do you get the produce and the flowers?
We have our customer base, our consignor base, which we call our people that bring our things in, is I think it's up in the 800 or 900. So we have up to 800 to 900 different people that bring us. Now, of course, they're not all here.
Right.
At 1 week. You know, each week I might have 50 to 75 different people.
So you're organizing it and getting it together.
Yeah.
So on a Tuesday morning, because I heard the buildings are empty Tuesday early in the morning, and that's when people start to bring it in.
After 6:30, they start rolling in, and I tell them to try to have it here by 1 o'clock when we start the auction. Now, if somebody's coming to shop or something, wants to bring a little something along, I'll let a few come in. And, you know, later through the day, but I try to tell them to have it here by 1 when we start the auction.
Okay. So I have two favorite stories to share with this auction. And one of them is up front at the produce auction.
Okay.
So I'm up front and I'm ready to bid because I have my little number and I love doing it. And you had something come in that was chocolate covered coffee beans.
Okay.
Unusual.
I remember that.
I love them.
Yeah.
So I bid 3. I thought, okay, 3 boxes of chocolate coffee beans. You don't get 3 boxes, you get 3 cartons.
Yeah.
I mean, what you're selling is really, you're not getting 5 bananas here at this auction. You're getting a, so with that, lo and behold, everybody around me had lots of energy for quite some time because we all had the coffee beans. And the other one is out back here by the flowers. I mean, I'm out and I'm bidding and bidding and bidding. And my dear late husband, I had to call him because lo and behold, I looked around at what all I bought. I needed a second car to come. And we had a lot of planning. But there's a lot of people like that,
all
right?
That's quite common. I just had a lady 2 weeks ago that she had to come back the next morning with her truck because she bought so many plants.
Yeah,
so.
See?
It happens all the time.
It does. It does.
I've seen them living here with loads on the roof racks of their vehicles already. So.
Yeah, because it's a flat of flowers.
Yeah.
It's not one pot of flowers. So you have to be prepared for that, which is a good thing.
Yeah.
It's fun. Because then you get to go home and share because you can get some really great prices.
A lot of this stuff, I'm surprised how many different people say that they don't use most of it they take home. I mean, there's some that do, but a lot of them say, I give them to people at church, people here, people there, and a lot of it just gets shared out.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, they use some themselves. But.
So what's some of the most unique things that you've had here at the auction?
Oh, one of the most unique things I ever remember was a tote about like sitting behind that truck there, and it was completely full. It had a plastic liner, and it was completely full of frozen sugar peas. That's one of the most unique
frozen
things.
Sugar peas.
Yeah, and it came in that way, so there was no way of breaking it up, so we sold the whole thing for one lump sum. I forget what it brought anymore, but it brought some money, but that's one of the most unique things I remember.
I was going to say, it's about a 5-foot by 4-foot container that you folks can't see what you're pointing to, but it's a big thing. That's a lot of sugar peas. Well, that's great.
Yes.
So tell me about the auctioneers. So where do they come from? Are they the same auctioneers every Tuesday?
Mostly. Every time. Sometimes I have regular ones, but sometimes I'll have to get fill in. Especially in the spring, I'll have to get extra auctioneers in.
Great.
Mostly we like to keep it a regular basis because our customers like that too when they know their numbers and everything. So
sure.
We try to keep them the same every week. So.
Yeah, because once you have a number here, it stays on record.
Yeah.
And then when you come back again, you get the same number.
Sure.
Yeah, I know it all too well.
Okay.
Well, any other last words you want people to know about the auction?
No, that's a pretty good overview of it.
Perfect. Well, I thank you for spending a few moments with me. Next, we get to go see some of the generation after generation of vendors that hopefully we'll find some baked goods along the way also. So we'll be right back. We're here with Margie Peters at, you know, the last place I stopped at, I said, oh, this is my favorite place. But you know what? I think maybe this is my favorite place. I'm terrible with Roots Market. And we're at Mary Jane's Bake Shop. So, Margie, welcome. And we appreciate you taking a moment for the folks of the 37th District to see what you do here at Roots Market. So you are the owner, manager of what's behind us. And I'll tell you, if our folks out there could smell what's happening here, it's incredible. But you're one of the few vendors that actually bake here on premise, right? At the market.
That's correct.
So tell me a typical Tuesday, what your Tuesday's like.
Okay, typical Tuesday, our first baker comes in around 11 Monday night, does some prep work. Second baker comes at 10. They spend all night. First they work on cookies, then they mix up yeast dough and start cranking out sticky buns, potato buns, cinnamon buns, cheese grades, and go from there.
And one of my favorite things is you have the glass up where the people walking by can actually see the food that they're about ready to purchase being made. Could you do it all day long then?
Yeah, the ovens usually shut down 3-4 o'clock in the afternoon.
3-4 o'clock.
Right.
And tell us about some of the products, cookies, bake, anything, bread?
We don't do bread. We do homemade potato buns, which are, of course, Pennsylvania Dutch.
Oh, absolutely.
Unique to the county. We do a cheese braid, which is more of a breakfast, kind of a Danish pastry. A lot of sticky buns. They're definitely
They're the most popular, I would assume, right?
And then we do what I call old-fashioned cookies. They would be your saucer-sized sugar cookies, old-fashioned blackstrap molasses, oatmeal raisin, and, of course, have to throw chocolate chip in there for everybody else.
You are making me so hungry.
Yeah.
So you have bought the business how long ago?
It'll be 14 years this October.
Oh, so you're not new at it.
No.
And who had it before?
Mary Jane and Wayne Maris. They're here from East Petersburg. And they were here for 40 years.
For 40 years.
So the establishment's been here for almost 55 years.
You know, it's almost like a family. I'm sure you build relationships with all the different vendors and...
We do. We see some people every week and we know what they're going to buy. We see other people, you know, once a month. And then we have the people that come when they come back to the county on vacation. And they just have to get to Roots on Tuesday to get fill in the blank.
Yeah, whatever it is they need.
Right.
What's your favorite part about it?
Oh, goodness. I love to bake. I like to be in, when I used to come in as the opening person, I like to watch the market wake up because we're in here at night by ourselves and it's dark.
Sure.
And the lights come on, the vendors come in, and of course,
it just starts to come to life.
It just unfolds.
Yeah, that's great. So, do you do any baking any other time during the week?
No.
So, Tuesday's it?
Yeah. Do a little bit of prep on Monday and long day on Tuesday, a little bit of bookwork on Wednesday, and I'm good.
And you're good. How many people do you employ behind?
How many people? We would have, let me think. Sounds terrible, I don't know. I'm going to guess 5 without going through the hoops.
So you learned to cohesively work back there together.
A little bit of space and a lot of emotion, yeah. We have a really good group of employees, and that makes it a lot more enjoyable.
That's fantastic. So this is it. This is what you do full time.
Well, not really.
Oh, okay.
My husband and I co-pastor a church.
Fantastic.
At the beginning of the week, and then I throw that in for good measure.
Oh, well, then you're a very busy woman. Absolutely.
No, I'm not wondering what to do with my time.
Yeah.
I like it that way. So.
Okay, and you're open as soon as the market opens in the morning, and how late do you go till you run out of food, or how's that
work?
We
like to sell out in our best business interests. That's what we should do.
Okay.
And so we're usually here till 9, but we don't always have a lot of product till 9.
Sure, right. Well, again, it's one of my favorite stops.
Okay.
I said I have a routine, and this is on the path.
Okay.
So.
Thank you.
All right, thank you,
sure,
Margie. I appreciate it. Next, we're going to head over to the Pretzel Factory. Again, that's another one generation after generation that they've been here on the ground. So come along. We are now with Norm Ressler with Norm Soft Pretzels. And Norm, you are one of the vendors that have been here for generation after generation. Are you fourth generation or fifth?
I'll be the fourth one in my family to have it.
You'll be the fourth one in your family to have it. And tell me from today's what it looks like compared to when your great-great-great-grandfather started it.
Well, when my great uncle is the one who started. When Leroy would have had it, the front probably looked a lot different. The bakery was added on to, I'm not sure when, it was a little before my time.
Okay.
But it went from my great uncle to my grandparents to my parents to me.
To you.
Yeah.
Do you have any siblings at all that...
I have one sister.
But she's not involved, or
no,
she is
she's
involved?
Not involved?
She's not involved.
It.
So it's all you,
right.
Huh?
Yeah.
So you're here. Tell me what your Tuesday looks like, because we're here on a Tuesday, and how does it start out?
Well, I get here about 5:30 in the morning, and I'm in there for the whole day till the end.
So you're in baking the whole time, because you actually are making the pretzels here?
Right. They're being made right here, and I have two machines back there that are built by my grandfather, and it rolls them out for me. I hand twist them. Lay them on a conveyor, but they get dipped automatically. I do peel them off the belt and salt them by hand and stick them in the oven by hand, though. And I usually have at least two or three girls up front selling this time of the year.
Okay, and are they just strictly soft pretzels, or do you do any specialty ones?
I have the regular soft pretzels, but we also have a medium and a jumbo pretzel. We have pretzel dogs. I have cinnamon, sugar, garlic, sour cream and onion, and also whole wheat.
Do you get any special requests from your clients that come?
Sometimes we do, yeah. They want either extra salty, want them darker, it all depends.
And you're more than willing to do it, I guess, huh?
Right, you usually try to do it. And we also have funnel cakes here too with sodas.
Oh, yum, that's great. So tell me about the clientele that come. Are they usually the same clients every year? I mean, every week, every Tuesday?
Pretty much so. You got people been buying here for years. As a matter of fact, not a lot anymore, but I know every so often to this day, I will get somebody to actually buy a pretzel from Leroy, and Leroy would have been the original owner.
Oh, you're kidding me.
And he hasn't been here since 69. But every so often, I will get somebody
that actually bought the original pretzels from years past.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness, how great. What's your favorite thing about Ritz Market?
Oh, I've always enjoyed it. I mean, I kind of grew up with it. I used to help my dad in here when I was little. It's always been nice working with Tom. He's always, Tom's always been good.
I hear that over and over as I'm talking to all the different vendors, the management with Tom Longenecker and the family, and how great they've always been.
Yeah.
Do you sell elsewhere, or are you just here at Ritz Market?
As of right now, I'm just here.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you, a lot of the other vendors, do you think they travel around from place to place?
Most of the vendors go from market to market, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great, great, great. So what's your most popular item real quick?
The regular soft pretzel is probably the hottest item.
Yeah. I may have to get one of those before I leave today.
All right.
Thank you. I appreciate you taking a moment to chat with us and letting the people out in the district know who you are and what you do here at Ritz Market.
Okay, thank you.
All right, you take care.
Yep.
So let's head back over to Tom at the office. We're going to wrap up and just finalize a few things about this great institution right here in the 37th District. Okay, so as I'm heading back over to the office, I see Tom and no other than, we talk about generation after generation coming, but Tom's daughter, Emily.
Yes.
Hi, Emily.
Hi.
Thanks for joining us.
Of course.
You are here as what role do you play right now?
I am in the office. I like to call myself an office intern.
So you're learning all the ropes about the market.
Yes.
And you work closely with your dad while you're here, right?
I do. On Tuesdays, I work the window, but on the off days, I'm in doing computer things with him.
So, okay, here we are, the younger generation. One of the things we have to get out and about is, of course, on the web. So do you work on the web pages? Or?
Yes, I do. We have been updating our website, and I have kind of been in charge of doing all of that. And then I also run the Facebook page as well.
Fantastic. Let's get the web page so people have it.
It's rootsmarket.com.
Good deal. So now let me ask you something else. While we're there, there's also other events you have here besides the just Tuesday's markets. Can you tell us just a little bit about those quickly?
Sure. We have a spring car show. The proceeds of the registrations benefits Clare House of Lancaster. We have a craft show, a juried arts and crafts show, the Labor Day weekend, Saturday and Sunday.
Yep.
And we have a fall car show that benefits Abby's Foundation, and then a fall Christmas open house. That's in November.
Oh, that's fantastic. And the fact that you help the proceeds go to great causes, that's a good thing.
Yes, that.
Yeah, so what's your favorite part about the market, Emily?
Just the atmosphere on Tuesdays. Just all the people, and I just love it here.
One of my favorite things, we interviewed Marianne with the bakery.
Yes.
And she said just watching the market open up and wake up and come to life, which is a great thing. And I'll tell you, I find the products around here so unique. I mean, as we're walking the market, there's coins, you know, somebody must be buying and selling old coins. I saw purple green beans, string green beans, which yep. I've never seen before. Every week must be a new adventure.
Mm-hmm. It's constantly changing, and I hear from my friends the variety that we have here. It's, you know, there's something for everybody.
There is something for everybody, and one of the great things that it lets local people come out and sell their local wares.
Right. There are a lot of times the people behind the stands are the person responsible for growing or making the items that they're selling. You get personal service, and we do whatever we can to support the local agriculture stand holder for growing and selling what they make and bake.
I tell you, I am fortunate enough to sit on the Ag Committee, which is by far my favorite committee up in Harrisburg, and to be able to talk to the farmers one-on-one, because I always say that, you know, people think that their food comes from a grocery store, and just not the case. So there's hardworking people behind the scenes. So I want to thank you very much for sharing Roots Market with the folks out in the district, and I appreciate you taking the time.
Oh, our pleasure.
Well, thank you for having us.
Thank you.
You bet. So again, I'm on the square of Mannheim. I'm also up in the Denver Municipal Building. You can feel free to contact me with any state-related issues. We have our webpage up and running, and you can always follow us on Facebook. So until next time, thank you for joining us here today at Rooks Country Market.